Hi, good morning. This is in continuation of the last lecture on upper bounds. There are one or two items which I would like to say and then continue to define LUB or supremum and work with it. Before that, let's go to the disclaimer. Yeah, I just wanted a clarification. My name, just because you see K-U-M-E-R, you start with Kumar and then you finish it Kumarism. Okay, so the actual pronunciation is Kumarism. Okay, just for fun. Okay, now let's go to the disclaimer page. How do I check whether I'm recording? So let us start. We define an upper bound for any non-empty subset A of R . So in the last lecture, for any non-empty subset A of R, we define an upper bound. Alpha is an upper bound of A. If for all X in A, we should have X must be less than or equal to alpha. Okay, all right. And also we define a lower bound. Right. And we also define what is meant by a subset being upper bound, bounded above. I can find an upper bound for the set A, then I say alpha is, A is bounded above by the upper bound, call it alpha. Okay. This is a small exercise. Usually this kind of thing you should do. But since this is the beginning of the course, I would like to go through this so that you will begin to think. Okay. So suppose I have the set A as above and alpha is an upper bound of A. Right. Let us look at minus A. What is minus A? It consists of all additive inverses of any element X in A. Okay. Don't say negatives. These are additive inverses of X. Okay. Collection of all additive inverses. Right. Now I want to know whether I can say anything about minus A. See, if alpha is an upper bound of A, then A is bounded above by alpha. Right. Now I have minus A. So let us look at a telling example. Suppose my A is minus infinity to 2. then minus a will be what? You would start with any x here. That means x is greater than or equal to 2. Therefore, it will be minus x, x less than 2. So this side, you can see, is minus 2 to infinity. If you want a slightly easier example, let us look at minus 4 to 3. Then minus j will be minus 3 to 4. Right? If you see that, you will see something very interesting happening. For example, as an upper bound for j, you can take it to 3. And for minus j, you see what happens? That's all you want to see. So what do you want to prove? We want to say something about x. Let us start with this. For every x in A, what do I know? X is less than or equal to alpha. Now, when x is in A, then minus x will be minus A. Therefore, I want to know how the inequality changes. So if I multiply by minus 1, then I have minus x, right? But when I multiply by a negative number, the inequality changes. So it is the other way around. Minus x is greater than or equal to minus alpha. Right? So what have I shown? You start with any element, okay? Take any element y in minus a, then there is an x in a, so that equal to y equal to minus x. And what have I shown about x? For every x in a, minus x is greater than or equal to minus alpha. That means for every y in minus a, I have shown that y is greater than or equal to minus alpha. So what does this say? This implies minus alpha is a lower bound of minus a. In particular, minus a is bounded below by minus alpha. You understand that? I start with this set A, which is bounded above by an upper bound alpha. Then what I know is minus a is bounded below by minus alpha. Just to make sure you can get this, a similar exercise let's give. Suppose B is again a non-empty subset of R and beta a lower bound of B. Okay, then what can you say about? Minus B. What is minus b? It is set of all additive inverses of elements coming from B. Okay, I'm sure you all of you know by now, but let me write it. Okay. Right. So let us look at one more thing. These kind of very small exercises are the one which make you confident, okay? Quickly you can think about, if you have not seen, when you go to big results, you need this kind of small results, then you did either you find it difficult or you are confused. Okay, so it's always good. This is what I call playing with. As soon as you see a definition, small definition, you just play with it. Look for some questions on your own, form some questions and answer them. Okay, right. Now the next one is, suppose I have a set A, again non-empty, etc. Suppose alpha is an upper bound of A, right? And further assume, this is an assumption, assume alpha is in A. Notice that in general, an upper bound need not be an element of A. For example, we saw, if I take 0, 1, the open interval, 1 is an upper bound, but 1 does not belong to the set A, right? So this is something special assumption. Okay, this is an assumption. Right, what can I say? So notice that first, there are two observations I want to make. First, see, if alpha is an upper bound of A, by very definition, for every x in A, x must be less than or equal to alpha. Right? You understand that? So now alpha is an element. So this has a special name, therefore. We say, okay, alpha is the maximum of A. Okay, this is the definition. What does it mean? When I say alpha is the maximum of A, two things must be true. What is it? Alpha is an upper bound of A, and two, alpha is an element of A. Then I say alpha is the maximum of A. You understand that? Yeah. This is a trivial observation. And two, suppose you say beta is an upper bound of A, the same A. Right? Now, what is the relation between alpha and beta? Remember, alpha is an upper bound of A. By our assumption, alpha is an element of A. And beta is an upper bound of A. Therefore, what is the relation? Alpha is less than or equal to beta. Right? This is a very trivial thing, but you should stop for a second and understand what I have shown. This is something very special. I have an upper bound of A. If it is an element of A, it is the smallest among all upper bounds of A. Do you understand that? How did I get it? Because alpha is an element of A. Is that clear? Okay. Right. Okay. And similarly, if suppose this is an exercise, how do you define minimum of a subset B of R? Okay, what should be the analog here? Okay, this is you should think about. So let us pause, review, and proceed. Now let's look at some cases. Let's look at, I'm going to define four kinds of intervals. I can start with A and B, but let us make life simpler. Let us start with 0, 1. This is one interval, call it J1. And there is another interval, J2, which is of course closed interval. And there is a third interval, J3, which is open at 0, closed at 1. And J4 is an interval which is closed at 0, open at 1. Yeah? Right. Do you observe something very interesting about all these things? Can you think of an obvious upper bound? There are many upper bounds, remember that? Right? Of course, obvious upper bound is 1. For all of them, right? Of course, anything greater than 1 naturally is going to be an upper bound. Okay, now let's go slow. Now, among these four, are there anything interesting? Intervals? Yes. What are the interesting intervals? This interval is interesting, and so is this interval. Do you see why? Because the upper bound 1 belongs to J2 and also it belongs to J3. Right? Therefore, 1 is a maximum of these two. Do you accept it? Very good. Next, let us look at. Okay. Now, what I want to claim, okay. If you give me beta, let's say why beta now, I can use alpha. Now suppose alpha is a real number, okay? Let's look at J1 for the timing. Suppose alpha is an upper bound of J1. Okay, the same thing will also work for J4. Okay, but let's just look at them. Okay, alpha is null. I want to say then, let's look at the picture. I have 0, I have 1, alpha is an upper bound, right? I want to know whether alpha can be less than 1. Can it happen? Yeah, let us look at intuitively first. Okay. Now suppose alpha, okay, is less than or equal to 0. Right? Then alpha cannot be an upper bound. Why? Because for example, I can take any element in 0, 1 and it will be greater than 0 and hence greater than, strictly greater than alpha. You understand that? Do you have an obvious element here? It's nice to say I can take any element, take this or some such thing, but it's always good to give a specific element. So if I take x equal to half, this belongs to J1. And half is strictly greater than 0 and which is greater than or equal to alpha, that means half is strictly greater than alpha, right? So alpha cannot be an upper bound. You understand that? Okay. Now the next thing I can ask, can alpha be positive greater than 0 but strictly less than 1? Can it happen? So now suppose my alpha is going to be somewhere here. Yeah. Now again, look at the picture. It tells me I can take some point between alpha and 1 in the open interval alpha and 1. Right? Take some point. Okay. This x will be in the interval 0, 1. Therefore, it's an element of the set and it's also greater than alpha. It looks all right. Yeah. But in mathematics, this kind of, this is a very good thing. Okay. Intuitively, it's very clear, such an alpha cannot be an upper bound, right? But in mathematics, it's always good to give an explicit point. For example, for this alpha, I gave half. For this alpha, I should give an element, right? What do I do is, let's look at alpha, okay, and this point 1. What is the point which is in between alpha and 1? That is alpha plus 1 by 2. That is called the midpoint. Of the interval alpha 1. Okay. This midpoint x will lie in the interval 0, 1 and it will also be greater than alpha. Okay. This x is strictly greater than alpha. Therefore, alpha is not an upper bound. Right. So, what I have shown? I have shown if alpha is less than 1, right? I broke it into two cases, alpha less than 1, but alpha lies between 0 and 1, or alpha is to the left of 0. That is, alpha is less than or equal to 0. This is case 1. This is case 2, right? In each of the cases, I have shown alpha cannot be an upper bound, right? Therefore, if alpha must be greater than or equal to 1. So we conclude. This is the conclusion. Right? You see that? Let us go through what you have shown. We took this interval J1. We know 1 is an upper bound. And what we found out, if you give me any upper bound alpha, then it must be greater than or equal to 1. That means among all upper bounds, 1 is the smallest or the least. Right? It's exactly similar to this. When alpha, an upper bound of A, is an element of A, then we said that alpha is the least among all upper bounds. Yeah, if beta is an upper bound, we said that beta alpha must be less than or equal to beta. Okay, please go through that. Okay. Now, this one which I did, I would like to look at it a little more closely. The one which I have done here, I will look at it more carefully. We will do in a more general setup. So, this item, we want to explain. More generally, let us look at two real numbers A, B, with A less than B, of course, A, B, NOR, as I said. Yeah? Then, the midpoint C, by definition, is A plus B by 2. Why it's called midpoint? I will give a reason why it's called midpoint, but it requires little knowledge about distance, etc. See, what is the distance between A and B? That is B minus A, right? Distance between A and B. Right? And so therefore, what is half the distance? It's a BA minus 2. B minus A by 2, right? So, how will I reach the midpoint? From A, I have to travel this much of distance. That means I have to travel A plus B minus A by 2. Or from B, I go backwards. That means I have to take B minus A by 2. You understand that? Now, are they equal? This is 2A, B minus A. Both are equal to. You see that? This is B minus A. This is 2A, therefore minus A. This is 2B minus B. Therefore, this is A plus B by 2. Do you understand that? That is why this is called the midpoint. C is called the midpoint of A and B. Now, if C is the midpoint of this, the fact we've used was something very interesting. That is, A is strictly less than C and C is less than B. This is our claim now. Okay. So, we want to prove this. This is very easy. When do I say, let us say, I will do one, the other one is easy. When do I say C is strictly less than B? If B minus C is positive. This is what I have to check. What is B minus C? It is B minus A plus B by 2, which is 2B minus A minus B by 2, which is B minus A by 2, which is positive. Of course, this I should guess because this is the midpoint and I am talking about B minus this. That means the distance between C and B. So, it should not be a surprise I should get this answer. Do you understand that? So, similarly, what should be C minus A then? Again, the same thing. So, this is strictly positive. Therefore, we have shown C lies strictly between A and B. Now, let's go back. Here, alpha lies strictly between 0 and 1, and I took x to be the midpoint of alpha and 1. Therefore, what do I know? X lies strictly between alpha and 1. That is, I have alpha strictly less than x, strictly less than 1. But remember, this alpha is also lies in the interval. Therefore, alpha is strictly greater than 0. Therefore, 0 less than x, less than 1. And hence, I conclude x is a point in the interval. And by very construction, by what I said here, this x being the midpoint of alpha and 1, x must be strictly greater than alpha. Okay? See, these are the things one quickly goes through, but it's always a good idea to go slow and understand very thoroughly. You could never be shaken off your confidence by this way. Okay? So, pause, review, and then proceed. So what I was shown? I was shown one is an upper bound of J1. Okay, so that if alpha is any upper bound of J1, then alpha is greater than or equal to 1, which is same as saying 1 is less than or equal to alpha. Do you understand this? And notice that the same thing is true for J2, that is obvious, because 1 is an element of J2. Similarly, 1 is an element of J3, and so the proof which I gave here, similar to that, can be given for J4. Therefore, let me write a very general statement. Therefore, 1 is an upper bound of JK, where K may be 1, 2, 3, 4, with the property if alpha, said that if alpha is an upper bound of JK, then alpha is greater than or equal to 1. Right? So let us just formula say it in orally. 1 is the least among all upper bounds. What does it mean? It's an upper bound. And when I compare 1 with any other upper bound, any upper bound, then 1 will be less than or equal to alpha. That means 1 is the smallest or the least among all upper bounds of any JK. You understand that? The same thing is what we saw earlier. If alpha is a member, is an upper bound, and alpha also belong to A, then alpha has the same property. What is the property? It is the least among all upper bounds of A. That's what we saw earlier. Yeah? Okay. Seen earlier. Right. Okay. Now let's look. So this kind of thing say something very interesting. Okay. The proof which I gave, again, this should you should try as an exercise. If A is less than B, look at J1, J2, JK defined by AB or AB or AB or AB. Then B will be an upper bound of J, and if beta is any upper bound of J, then B should be less than or equal to B. The same proof. Okay, you should try, discuss among your friends so that you'll be know how to do that. So notice that this kind of questions may not be asked, so usually people don't spend time. But when you go higher studies, when this kind of facts are used, you lack confidence to work with them. Okay, so please go through this and spend a little time. You will reap huge benefits as you go along. Okay, right. So now what you have shown is this kind of upper bounds are something special. Notice that B is an upper bound with this property. It is least among all upper bounds of J, where J is open and only AB, but B is not an element of J for this J, right? So we want to, these are very special among all upper bounds, so we want to give a name. So let us start with the set A, subset of R, which is non-empty. Suppose alpha is a real number, then I say alpha is a least upper bound. I will write it as short LUB. A more fashionable word for that is supremum. A Latin word. Supremum of A. If alpha satisfies two conditions. What should it be? Before going to this, just reflect just for a minute. I have a class in which I say Mr. X is the shortest boy. What am I saying? I am saying X is a boy, and X is a boy short, is X is shortest among boys. Okay, there may be a girl who is shorter than him in the class. You understand that? When I say X is the shortest boy, X must be a boy, and among all boys, he must be the shortest. So the least upper bound, when I say alpha is the least upper bound of A, what should it be? Alpha must be an upper bound of A. Two, if beta is an upper bound, don't write any other, it is just upper bound. For example, beta might have been alpha also for me. So if beta is an upper bound of A, then I want to compare alpha and beta. What should be the relation? I want alpha to be the least among upper bounds. Therefore, alpha should be. You understand? Try to go through in your mind. Least upper bound must be upper bound and least among upper bounds. So the first condition, upper bound. Second condition, least among upper bound. That means you have to start with an upper bound. If beta is an upper bound of A, then I should compare beta with alpha. I want alpha to be the least upper bound. Therefore, the relation should be alpha less than or equal to beta. Is that clear? So what have we shown now? In the last examples, we have shown the following. One, if alpha an upper bound is also an element of A, then alpha is the LUB of A or the supremum of A. And similarly, for any of the interval J, which is either open or closed or semi-open, semi-closed or whatever you want to call it, for all this, beta is the, sorry. P is the LUB of J. We have done it for the open interval 0, 1, etc. But it's the same case. Yeah? You follow that? Okay. If you notice, I said alpha is a least upper bound. Right? If you know your English grammar well, you will see it's the least is a superlative degree. So I should write is the least. English teacher will correct me. Right? Yeah. The reason mathematicians are slightly more careful. Okay? You will see the reason. Maybe that's the reason why people started calling supremum. Anyway. Yeah. The reason is, it is conceivable. I can just imagine there may be two real numbers alpha and beta in R, so that alpha is also a least upper bound of A and beta is also least upper bound of A. Because for alpha to be least upper bound of A, it has to satisfy these two conditions. Right? If you want, let me call it alpha 1 and alpha 2. If alpha 2 has to be least upper bound, what the properties it should have? Alpha 1 must be an upper bound of A. If beta is an upper bound of A, then alpha 1 should be less than or equal to beta. That's it. Similarly, alpha 2. Right? Okay. Now, what we want to prove is uniqueness. What does that mean? If you tell me two real numbers, alpha 1 and alpha 2 are least upper bounds of A, then I want to claim alpha 1 is equal to alpha 2. Therefore, once it's unique, then we will say the unique number will be called the least upper bound of A. Right? Okay. Now, why should it be true? Okay. Now, what we are going to do is a partially blind game. What is partially blind? Okay. Given alpha 1 and alpha 2, for one of them, I'll give the full status. For the other one, I'll give only half status. It's a secondary, second class citizen kind of thing. So alpha 1 may be the first class citizen, alpha 2 may be second class citizen, and role reverse. Okay, is it confusing? Don't worry, you'll do that. Now you told me alpha 1, okay, let's take alpha 1, consider it as a full-fledged least upper bound. Now alpha 2 is a least upper bound. In particular, it's an upper bound. Alpha 2 and upper bound. You see that now I am partial to alpha 2. Even though it is also a least upper bound, I do not consider it as a least upper bound. I consider it fully as an upper bound. Okay, so it's a second class citizen for me. Therefore, what's the relation between alpha 1 and alpha 2? Alpha 1 is a least upper bound. Alpha 2 is an upper bound of A, right? Therefore, alpha 1 should be less than or equal to alpha 2. Do you understand this? Now, I will elevate alpha 2, the first class citizen. Therefore, I will consider this as LUB of A. And alpha 1, I will consider only as an upper bound of A. Right? Now, since alpha 2 is a least upper bound of A and alpha 1 is an upper bound of A, what's the relation between alpha 2 and alpha 1? So now let's look at these two things. So I was sure if alpha 1 and alpha 2 are least upper bounds of A, then I proved alpha 1 is less than or equal to alpha 2 and alpha 2 is less than or equal to alpha 1. Therefore, by law of trichotomy, I should get alpha 1 equal to alpha 2. Pause, review, and proceed. So hereafter, I will say alpha is the least upper bound because of uniqueness, right? So I will write alpha as the LUB of the set A. Is it clear? Okay. Now let's go back. We define a lower bound of a set, right? Suppose beta is a lower bound of the set A, right? Anything, any gamma less than equal to beta, then gamma is also lower bound, right? So what should I look for? I look for the greatest among lower bounds. Let us look at again a simple example. Let us take 0, 1. As we did earlier, 0, they call it J. 0 is a lower bound of J. Right? And if you tell me any beta is a lower bound of J, then you know beta will be less than or equal to 0. Okay, it's okay. Take it as an exercise if you want. This is exactly similar to the way we did. See, these are all quick. Don't lose heart or anything. Once you understand this, you will see that you can go through it quickly. Okay, don't hesitate. Don't think it's a waste of time. It should be obvious or I can prove it. No, you should prove it. Okay, then beta is less than. Therefore, 0 is a lower bound, and given any lower bound of J, then beta must be less than or equal to 0. Therefore, 0 is the greatest among lower bounds. So, I ask you to define, okay, GLB of your set A. That is the greatest lower bound. This word. Okay. This is also known as the Latin word infimum. Usually one writes this infimum of A, and the earlier case one writes it supremum of A. You write inf A, sup A, but you read it infimum A or supremum A. Okay? Right. But notice that among an upper bound monad exists. We had already seen the example. Suppose I take A to be the set 0, infinity, that is set of all positive reals. Then this is not bounded above. Therefore, no upper bound exists. Since no upper bound exists, naturally, the least upper bound you cannot even talk of. Right? Why no upper bound exists? If you say alpha is an upper bound, notice that alpha must be positive. Why? Suppose alpha is an upper bound of A, I claim alpha is positive. Why? Remember, 1 belongs to A. Therefore, since alpha is an upper bound of A, alpha must be greater than or equal to 1, and hence alpha is positive. Is it okay? Right. Now, therefore, in particular, alpha is an element of A. Now, if I take x equal to alpha plus 1, then this is also positive, therefore, this is an element of A. But x is strictly greater than alpha. Therefore, this implies, okay, alpha is not an upper bound, a contradiction. Right? So, this set cannot be bounded above. Remember, when I say it's not bounded above, what should I say? Give me any alpha. I can find a number x, I can find an element x in A so that x is greater than alpha. Have I done that? Yes. Therefore, this set is not bounded above. Is it okay? Yeah. So, what are the things I have done now? I have first defined the analogous concept, greatest lower bound, which is analogous to least upper bound. I also gave an example and I also proved the set of positive reals is not bounded above. And let us look at minus infinity to zero. This is not bounded below. Okay. Do it as an exercise. The same thing. Yeah. If you give me, it's not bounded below, what should I show? I should find a number which is less than this, an x here. But that's very easy. Notice that beta minus 1 belong to B. Therefore, what should be the relation between beta and minus 1? Therefore, beta is negative in particular. Therefore, beta is an element of B. Yeah? Now, beta, therefore, if I take x equal to beta minus 1, then I have this. Yeah? Okay, quickly go through that. So let us look at another way of saying, okay, this is the second definition of least upper bound. I say alpha is LUB of A if the first condition remains the same, namely alpha is an upper bound A, and two, if you say delta, if you give me a real number delta which is less than alpha, then delta is not an upper bound. Okay. I claim the earlier definition, call it as definition 1, and these two definitions are equivalent. The proof is easy, right? I am going to only orally say that thing. I ask you to pay attention, then we will do PRP. Okay? Okay. Now, let us assume alpha LUB according to definition 1. Then I have to say alpha is LUB of A according to definition 2. Right? Okay. So, what is that I have to prove? First, I have to prove alpha is an upper bound of A. Yathotike. Is correct. Yeah, because alpha is LUB according to definition 1. There, also the first condition is this. Very good. Now, next, what do I have to do? I have to prove second condition is also met. That means you are going to give me a delta which is less than alpha. Right? Then what should I show? I have to prove that. I'm sorry. Let me go back. alpha is an upper bound of, if alpha is LUB of A, if alpha is an upper bound of A, and if delta is less than alpha, then delta, the smaller number, is not an upper bound of A. Intuitively, I expect alpha to be the least, therefore anything less than I cannot be an upper bound. That's what we are writing. I'm sorry for this. Okay, right, come back. So alpha is the LUB of A according to definition 1. I have to check alpha is least upper bound according to definition 2. That means alpha should satisfy these two conditions. First condition, of course, yes. Second condition, suppose you give me a delta which is less than alpha. I have to prove delta is not an upper bound of A. Okay, suppose not. Suppose delta is an upper bound of A. Right? Now, what do I know about alpha? Alpha is the least upper bound of A according to definition 1. And you say delta is an upper bound of A. Therefore, since alpha satisfies condition 2 of definition 1, what is condition 2 of definition 1? If beta is an upper bound of A, then alpha should be less than or equal to beta. You understand that? Now you say delta is an upper bound of A and alpha is the least upper bound according to definition 1. Therefore, by definition 1, I conclude that alpha should be less than or equal to delta. You understand that? But are they contradicting each other? Look at this and look at this. We started with delta less than alpha, but we concluded delta is greater than or equal to alpha. This contradicts law of trichotomy. Therefore, my assumption that delta is an upper bound of A, this is incorrect. Right? So if delta is less than alpha, then delta is not an upper bound of A. You follow that? Okay. So if alpha is an upper bound, according to definition 1, alpha is an upper bound of A. And if you give me any delta less than alpha, I prove delta is not an upper bound of A. That means alpha is an upper bound of A according to definition 2. Spend some time. Okay. These are the kind of thing you should be able to think instead of writing. Okay. So I proved definition 1 implies definition 2. Now I want to prove definition 2 implies definition 1. So let alpha be an LUB of A according to definition 2. Okay. Now I want to prove alpha is an upper bound, least upper bound of A according to definition 1. The first condition, alpha is an upper bound of A. That's okay. Because alpha is least upper bound according to definition 2, therefore it is. Next, now you give, next, if I prove, want to prove alpha is least upper bound of A according to definition 1, it has to satisfy the second condition. What is the second condition? If you give me beta an upper bound of A, then this should happen. Alpha should less than or equal to beta should happen. Right? So, now let beta be an upper bound of A, then I have to prove. What should I prove? Alpha is less than or equal to beta. Is this true? Alpha is less than or equal to beta. Okay? Suppose false. I want to prove that, but suppose false. That means, what does it mean? Beta is greater than or equal to alpha is false, therefore beta is strictly less than alpha. Then, let me write so that you will know. Suppose false. Then what happens? Beta is not greater than or equal to alpha. That means beta is strictly less than alpha. But remember, alpha is LUB according to definition 2. And you gave me a beta which is less than alpha. Therefore, the second condition in definition 2 says, if any number is less than alpha, that number is not an upper bound of A. Therefore, what do I conclude? Therefore, I conclude beta, definition 2 implies beta is not an upper bound of A. Is that a contradiction? Yes, because I started with beta as an upper bound of P. Right? Okay. Therefore, I have proved it. If alpha is the least upper bound of A according to definition 2, then alpha is the least upper bound of A according to definition 1. Okay? So, it's quite a lot. And if this is the first time you are going through this kind of argument, it's better to pause, review, and proceed. But believe me, spending time on this kind of thing, and do not worry about writing. Okay? Nobody will ever ask this in your exam paper. So try to understand this. So I want to have few more things before I close. Okay. Right. So we have given an equivalence definitions, right? Okay. Now just let us stop for an example. See, I didn't want to give this example together because after somewhat deeper layers, little more involved, subtle arguments, I want to make life easy. Like a comedy scene in a serious movie, right? Some lightning movement should be there so that it is, okay, you are not stressed too much, right? So suppose A is a non-empty finite subset of R, right? Then I want to say A has a maximum. Do you remember our definition of maximum? Which is same as saying there is an upper bound of A, which is also an lower bound of A. And hence, any upper bound of A which belongs to the set is by definition least upper bound. Yeah? Right. Let's just quickly do that. Suppose alpha has an upper bound of A and alpha is in A, that implies alpha is the LEB of A. We had already seen, but let's quickly again go through that. Since alpha is an upper bound of A, I want to prove alpha is least upper bound of A. Therefore, I have to prove two things. Alpha is an upper bound of A, that is given. Second thing is, if beta is an upper bound of A, then I have to prove alpha less than or equal to beta. This I have to prove. But remember, beta is an upper bound of A, right? And alpha is an element of A. Since alpha is an element of A, and beta is an upper bound of A, what is the relation between alpha and beta? Alpha is less than or equal to beta. Therefore, this theorem is proved. Okay? But remember, an upper bound of A need not be an element of the set. Okay? We had already seen examples. Okay, come back to this. Suppose A is a finite set. I want to say A has a maximum. Okay? Let us prove, let the number of elements in A equal to n. Let us start with n equal to 1. If n equal to 1, it has only one element, therefore that element is maximum. Right? Is that clear? Okay. Now suppose I have proved the result for any n k, that is if A has k elements, okay, then there exists an x in A such that x is greater than or equal to A for all A in A. That is, x is a maximum. Is that okay? This is the induction hypothesis. Now suppose I have set A which k plus 1 elements. Okay, let us write it. A1, AK, AK plus 1. Right? What do I look at? I look at the set B, which consists of the first K elements. Now, B has only K elements. By induction hypothesis, there exists an X in B. It may be one of the AJ. Okay, let's not worry about what it is. There is an x in B so that x is greater than or equal to aj for 1 less than or equal to j less than or equal to k for every element. This element is a maximum among all these elements. Okay. Now let's look at the two element set. X and ak plus 1. Now remember, these are two real numbers, right? Therefore, by law of trichotomy, either x is less than or equal to ak plus 1 or ak plus 1 is greater than x. Sorry, this is what I am writing. So, what I want is x is less than. X is less than equal to or x is strictly greater than ak plus 1. Right? Okay. You can even let us make somewhat easier. Suppose x is strictly less than ak plus 1 or x is greater than or equal to ak plus 1. Right? Now let's look at this case. If x is greater than or equal to ak plus 1, we know it's x is greater than a1, x is greater than a2, x is greater than ak. Therefore, x is also greater than or equal to ak plus 1. Therefore, x is the maximum of a. Is it clear? Now, suppose x is less than ak plus 1. Then, I claim ak plus 1 is maximum of a. Is it obvious? Yeah. Ak plus 1 is greater than or equal to ak plus 1. But ak plus 1 is greater than x, but that x is greater than or equal to aj. Therefore, ak plus 1 is greater than aj for j between 1 and k. You understand that? So, what I have shown now, if I have a finite, non-empty finite set, okay, it has a maximum. Therefore, what is the LEB of that set? It is the unique maximum. Yeah? Okay. So, before we stop the lecture, I just want you to introduce one more concept and I want you to think about. Right? Let us assume alpha is the LUB of a non-empty subset A. Do you remember we already said something about minus A, the set of additive inverses of elements of A? Yeah? Right. And remember, if alpha is the least upper bound, alpha is an upper bound of A. If alpha is an upper bound of A, what do I know? Minus alpha is a lower bound of minus A. We have seen it. Yeah? What do you think I should like to prove now? Alpha is not an upper bound, it's a least upper bound. Right? Just because alpha is an upper bound, I concluded minus alpha is a lower bound of minus a, that we concluded earlier. Where did you conclude? I think it is the first thing or second thing today. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, we can use this. We'll come back. Right, so I'm sure all of you thought about this. I would like to claim minus alpha is the GLB of minus A. Okay. This is what we want to prove. So, the proof is exactly the same way we proved earlier, but it will be worth going through. Okay, let us look at. So, what we want to do is this. Suppose beta is a lower bound of minus A. I want to say minus alpha is the greatest lower bound of minus A. Therefore, what should I prove? What should be the relation between beta n minus alpha. I want this to be the greatest lower bound. Given any lower bound beta, therefore I want to prove this. Is that clear to you? Yeah, this is very easy. Just you have to keep thinking. Yeah. Now suppose beta is a lower bound of A. Start with any y. Therefore, for any y in minus A, what is the relation between y and beta? Beta is less than or equal to y. Right? Yeah. But how do elements of minus A look like? If I say y belong to minus A, then that means there exists an x. This implies there exists an x in A so that y equal to minus x. Yeah? That's the definition. Therefore, what do I know is beta is less than or equal to minus x. Where is x? X is in A. For which x? For all x. Do you understand that? Because any y of this form. Now instead, if you give me any x in A, then I can take y equal to minus x. You understand that? Yeah? Okay. So for every x in A, if I take y equal to minus x, then beta is less than or equal to minus x. Okay, is that clear? Right. Therefore, for every x in A, this is true. Therefore, I multiply this by minus 1. So, minus 1 times this inequality will give me minus beta is greater than or equal to x. For which x? For every x in A. You follow that? For every x in A, x is less than or equal to minus beta. Therefore, what does it say about minus beta? Minus beta is an upper bound. But what is given? It was given alpha is the least upper bound of A. Right? And you tell me now, minus beta is an upper bound of A. Therefore, what am I supposed to conclude? Alpha must be less than or equal to minus beta. Since why? Because alpha is supposed to be the least upper bound of A. And beta is an upper, minus beta is an upper bound of A. Now this implies, again multiplying by minus 1, the inequality reverses the sign. Therefore, minus alpha is greater than or equal to beta. Yeah, now let's go back. What am I supposed to show? You give me beta any lower bound of minus A, I have to show beta is less than or equal to minus alpha. Have I shown that? Yes. Therefore, the claim is true. What do we conclude? If alpha is the LUB of A, that implies minus alpha is the GLB of minus A. Okay, this will play an important role, right? Okay, now before ending, okay, I will say, is there a PRP time? Yes. Pause, review, and proceed. Okay, I think we are done enough for today. In the next lecture, we will introduce the so-called LUB property of R and deal with that. Okay, but before going, I would like to leave some exercise. Suppose C is positive. Okay, alpha is the LUB of A. Let us look at the set CA. I think we had already seen that. It is C times X, where X is in A. Then what do you guess? LUB of Ca will exist and it is nothing other than C times alpha. Okay. These are the extensions of what you have proved for upper bounds. Now I want you to prove for least upper bounds. And similarly, let alpha be the LUB of A and beta be the LUB of B. And remember A plus B, it is set of all X plus Y, where X is in A and Y is in B. Then what do you think I want you to prove? LUB of the new set A plus B is alpha plus beta. Try these things. Okay. Okay. With this, we'll stop. We will meet again when we will introduce the LUB property of R, which is the cornerstone, which is the aadhar of real analysis. Okay. Have a good day.